Thanks for tuning in to the World XP Podcast. If you're enjoying the content, please drop a sub, drop a like, and let us know your thoughts below in the comments. Also, please consider supporting our podcast via the link below. It really helps us out.
Andrew, welcome to the World XP Podcast, man. How are you?
I'm good, thanks. Good to finally sit down and chat. I know we've been close buds for, almost like 2.5 years now. So it's good to finally be on. We're just talking about how I was listening to some of the recent episodes, stuff like that. So excited to finally have my my shot in the hot seat. So
yeah, 100%. So why don't you do a quick intro? For those listening, we're gonna hit a variety of topics. Andrew works in an industry that I think most people is very foreign. But you also, obviously, we know each other from soccer and a few other things here and there. So why don't you do a quick intro, and then we can, as our new tradition, you can take your question from the previous guest, and then we'll jump right into it.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, my name's Andrew Jenis. I'm 29 years old, 29 and a half. So I got the 30th birthday coming up this year. So midlife crisis, existential crisis incoming. But yeah, I'm from the DC area. Currently live in Old Town Alexandria with my wife, two corgis. So yeah, just living the dream. Life's been going really well lately. As you mentioned, you know, big soccer fan, have the sort of the Blazers football club team that I run. It's taken up a lot of my time, as well as you know, working in the fintech space. I'm fully remote, working from home, so I'm here in my home office. So yeah, it's just a normal night talking on Zoom. So that's how most of my day is, between working out and then on Zoom. So
fair enough. All right, so so the question from the previous guest, and it's actually, so it's not from the one that was actually, I recorded them out of order, but it's from Dr. Singh, who was the one that was two episodes ago. He said, in your field of expertise or your industry, what is your single biggest issue or single issue that gives you the biggest headache?
So the specific industry that I work in is in cross-border payments, or sort of the global payments industry. And definitely a thing that is sort of keeps I guess me up at night, or the industry leaders up at night, is just how the different regulatory bodies, whether you go from the European Union or the Americas, or trying to do payments in LATAM, whatever it may be, they all have sort of different rules, different regulations, different tax policies when funds are coming in and out of the country, all these things that you sort of have to keep track of. And so, you know, like in 2024, there was new EU regulations that were launched, which for my company, we then had to do sort of different compliance procedures to sort of match the EU regulations that are constantly changing and stuff like that. So I think that, in an industry like global payments, how it really matters and sort of varies geo by geo and region by region, to sort of be keeping sort of your standards and sort of policies up to standard, based off of constantly changing sort of regulatory schemes. So
that sounds miserable. not gonna lie. So if somebody was to say, or that somebody could also be me, you mentioned fintech. I know what that acronym or that abbreviation is, because we're friends and we've talked before. But for those listening that have no idea, like, if you were to describe it as, like, what is fintech? Like, how would you describe it?
Like, yeah,
an elevator type pitch.
Yeah, so from my understanding, the term fintech kind of came out, you know, around the turn of the 21st century, because it's essentially this group of companies and industries that are sort of replacing what we consider like the legacy banking industries, right? So it could be anything ranging from, you know, something like what my company does, which is cross-border payments specifically. So, you know, the old legacy ways, you have to go to your bank, you'd have to send a wire instruction. It'd be super manual, it'd be super expensive. You wouldn't know what exchange rate you were getting, all these other things. And so, you know, we've essentially modernize, I guess, that process, if you're talking about cross-border payments specifically. So it's things like transparent foreign exchange rates. The money's getting there in seconds, as opposed to days or weeks with sort of legacy banking systems. You know, it can all be sort of monitored and watched from an app, you know, things of that nature. And so that's just like cross-border payments specifically. But, you know, there are also things with regards to compliance that I would say are in the fintech world, or just more like in the cards, like card issuing and all that stuff. And so there are a bunch of these sort of sub industries, I guess, beyond sort of the legacy banking systems that have sort of evolved as sort of technology has allowed us to do that. And so sort of broadly speaking, that umbrella of fintech is those ways that we're sort of, you know, modernizing those legacy banking systems. So
how much are you involved in, or not you personally, but how much is your like industry involved? Is it a niche within the finance industry? Because you look at things like the Federal Reserve or like the big, like the JP Morgan Chases of the world, and the interest rates for mortgages and all the those sorts of things. Are you an integral player in that, or is it more of a niche thing? Is fintech like readily involved, yeah, or is it more like, how does that work? Like, if you were to say somebody that would like watch the news or whatever, or kind of pay attention loosely to economics, how would you say that your industry interfaces with like the mainstream sort of like terms that economic terms that are thrown out there?
Yeah, it's actually a great question, and it's something that I would consider like we're like a frenemy of someone like a JP Morgan Chase, right? So the irony is that in a lot of places we still need actually those like big legacy banks to actually hold on to the money or actually be the ones moving the money, but at the same time they sort of want our technology, they want to be using our technology, they like how we have, you know, we can move much, much quicker. You know, when you say, hey, we're releasing a new version of our product, we can do that in a week's time, as opposed to JP Morgan is a, you know, huge dinosaur of an organization. It would take months to probably even put together a project plan. And so it's this, yeah, like I said, it's a frenemy situation where we kind of both need each other still, because there's something to be said about like having the backing of a JP Morgan Chase, which has $1 trillion under asset and is sort of always going to be bailed out and is never a sort of fear of going under. While at the same time, you know, they're always trying to look to the future and sort of evolve themselves as well. And so they like some of the technological advances and sort of the, some of the things that we're able to do with our sort of more, I guess, lean, modernized tech. So yeah, sort of organizations across, and you know, my familiarity is mostly with that cross-border payment space where, you know, everyone is, for example, like, you know, JP Morgan might use my company's payment rails to get funds to a specific area of the world, but we might use them for a different area of the world and vice versa. So that's why it's kind of the world of fintech, I would say, is very much so sort of co-mingled and frenemy sort of relationship. So,
yeah. That makes sense. So are you, I don't know, I would assume you remember this, but a few years ago, all these like Forex traders came out that were like, oh, I made $1 million like trading on the exchange rates and stuff. Like, yeah. What is, like, I know what it is, but I don't know it well enough to explain it to somebody else. Can you kind of talk to that? Because now it kind of moved into, I don't know if you remember, people's Instagram accounts would get hacked and they'd be like, oh, I made $1 million, because then they'd tag some random account and be like, oh, I became a Forex trader. And now it's like, oh, I invested into crypto or whatever. Like, but what is I assume that it was to some extent a real thing, like trading on the exchange rates or whatever. But like, how does, so using that as like the framework, but more broadly speaking, when you talk about exchange rates, it's very simple to say, oh well, one pound, British pound, is worth X number of dollars and vice versa. But how does that work when you talk globally, right? Because some things are backed by the dollar, like the oil used to be backed by the dollar, and then some things was backed by gold, and then so how does that all kind of like fill in and mix together? Because from my understanding, it's like nobody actually really understands. It's just like a thing that is now.
Yeah. No, it is very complicated, and I'm gonna be honest, where I'm not like a foreign exchange, I'm not like a day trader by any means, and there's a whole sort of industry behind that my company doesn't really sort of get involved with, as far as we kind of just pull the rates from Reuters, which is like a large reputable organization, yeah, that sort of publishes rates, and we have APIs that are essentially getting that live rate just from them like every couple minutes. And so yes, you can definitely be sort of hedging on certain currency pairs to be like, hey, I think compared, you know, I feel like this week, because of this macroeconomic news, like the Indian rupee is going to fall in relation to the dollar. And so you might, you know, make a big bet and move all of your Indian rupees into dollars to then, you know, switch it back to Indian rupees later that week or whatever it may be. And so, yes, there definitely is like this, the whole sort of foreign exchange industry trading. You can definitely, smart people can definitely still make a lot of money off of those calls and stuff like that. But As far as sort of the things that I'm sort of specializing in, it's more on the specific local payment and like the delivery methods and sort of the speed and all those things, and less on like the hedging of currencies and stuff like that. Because I think that, like with any sort of trading, there's huge risks involved and stuff like that. And the specific industry I'm in is more like we're taking a set margin off of every sort of payment that we deliver. And so we're less sort of concerned about the actual sort of day-to-day sort of spreads that we're seeing. So
it's weird to me, or not weird, it's interesting to me. Your answer sparked a few thoughts in my head, is that there's so many ways to make money and with the way that the global economic system is set up that have very little to do with actually, well, I'll say actually working for your time, right? So like, as you know, there's things that are scalable and things that are not, and things that are scalable, things that are not scalable is working for your time. You only have so many hours in the day. But if you do enough research, you can make bets against whether it's the stock market or the foreign exchange rates or crypto or whatever, like all these different mechanisms to make money. Now we're like the Sam Bankman-Frieds of the world and all these people with pump and dump schemes and all this stuff. Like the finance system as a whole seems to be robust enough to not have completely collapsed, but at the same time it feels like it's not very robust, if that makes sense. So how do you, as somebody working in the space and in the industry, like look at the economic system as a whole, like considering like fractional reserve banking and all this other stuff, where like fractional reserve banking is its own thing. It's like, well, if everybody went to go get their money, there's actually not all that money that is left. And it's like, it just feels like the whole thing can just come tumbling down. But at the same time, we've been through COVID, we've been through the like 08 market crash, and you can argue if how we really were saved or not saved, or if we should have printed money or not printed money, but we're still here and it's still working in this. Like, how do you, as somebody in the space, like look at that and like from a very macro view?
Obviously I'm not giving out any sort of like investment advice or anything like that, but my personal philosophy is always to like tie it to actually things that are like tangible, where you can see you're like actually making a physical impact, you know. So I don't really trade at all. I don't really trade stocks at all. I don't trade crypto at all, just because I think I'm also at a point in my career where I can I'm doing pretty well for myself, just like with my own sort of salary and sort of everything that's going on around that. But as far as like my sort of job and sort of how I sort of conceptualize with the importance of what I do, like just as like an easy example. So like I work with a lot of like freelancer platforms or gig worker platforms, like your Ubers or your Airbnbs of the world, right? And so what our sort of platform allows them to do is pay out those gig workers quickly, more cheaply, more cost effectively, faster, in their local currency, direct to their own bank accounts, right? And so that's like a physical thing where like we're improving on that process, where they used to be getting charged, let's say, $10 to get their money in their local currency, and now we've made it 50 cents, you know. And so hearing the stories of like, hey, I am a software engineer and I'm on this freelancer platform that's doing like website designs for US companies or something like that, like a real story, right? And hearing the feedback of like, hey, I can now get paid, like, you know, I'm literally making 50% more because it's, you know, I'm not having to go through like Western Union or these legacy banking systems to get my money and stuff like that. So I personally, and again, it's just my personal thing, like have to be doing work and or like making sort of career investment decisions where like there is that tangible impact that you can tie it to. And that's been really important to me, and also makes my work like a lot more rewarding. So
yeah, that makes total sense. How does like a PayPal or a Venmo or a Zelle fit into that?
So like we have like connections or plugins with PayPal. We're kind of like even a PayPal sort of PayPal destroyer, in the fact that like they still take crazy fees and stuff like that. Like, say you have a PayPal wallet and you're like in Brazil, right? To actually move that money to your external bank account in Brazilian reais is like crazy, still crazy expensive through PayPal. And so, you know, you can just use our platform or our rails to move it directly from US dollars or whatever currency you're getting paid into your Brazilian reais and get it a lot cheaper, a lot more cost effective. So, we're again, as sort of another like frenemy situation where like we have direct plugins to PayPal, because a lot of people have like PayPal wallets is a pretty common way to like pay or get paid around the world. Right. But then it's that last mile part of like, okay, great. I have this, you know, $10,000 in my PayPal wallet that I've worked, you know, to over my last couple of projects to have. How do I actually go out and like use that or spend that at my local grocery store, whatever it may be? And so that's where then actually being able to move that to your own sort of external bank account is where sort of our platform and our sort of rails come into play. So
That makes sense. Cause it's, I guess, so when you pull it out of a PayPal or wherever into your bank account, is that where all the regulations and the restrictions and the taxes and stuff hit?
Yeah, exactly. So you want someone who's well versed in that, who, you know, in our case, we're already plugged into like, let's just use like that Brazil example, right? Like we already have local Brazilian accounts is actually moving the money and we're tied into that banking network already. And so, it's about giving sort of transparency and speed and sort of cost effectiveness to those customers, as opposed to, you know, I think PayPal will charge at least a couple percentage points to actually move that money to your bank account. And that goes back to sort of how the conversation started, right? Like you still need those big banks, like in those local markets, right? I mean, that's where that sort of whole frenemy relationship lies, because there's still something we said about like, hey, this is a big, safe bank with lots of, with lots of other assets that, you know, the local resident or whoever like feels comfortable storing and holding their money with them. So that part is still like important as part of the overall like flow of funds. So.
That's super interesting, because paying overseas, like for example, I had bought some soccer stuff, some equipment from like England or whatever. And I didn't, obviously, besides shipping, the price was what the price was, and that's what came out of my account. Mm-hmm. So is that something that as a consumer, you don't really notice as much, the things that you're talking about?
Yeah, I'm sure there was maybe, you know, if you actually went and saw what the live foreign exchange rate was at the moment you press transact, I'm sure there was at least a percentage point or so of additional fees you were probably taking on like in that. It is kind of deceptive how some, you know, platforms will know that like you think you had, oh, there's some sort of conversion rate happening here. And like, that sounds about right. But they can, a lot of times they can still eke out a percentage point or two, because you know, the average consumer is not going to be like having a Reuters live API feed of like what the current market rate is. Yeah, so.
Yeah. But it was real, like it said, for example, like, oh, the price of this is $50. And then that the number that said it was on the website was the same number that came out of the account. So obviously within the exchange rate, I'm sure some whatever happened, but by and large, so like, I didn't really see it, that hit that you're talking about. So does that happen more on like the seller end?
Yeah, exactly. They probably have some deal with their bank where, or maybe their bank just has a deal with a player like us, right? Where they're getting a certain rate and then they're getting a certain fee attached to it. And it's sort of just built into the consumer sort of end price. I mean, I see that all the time where because the thing with the financial in the sort of the global money movement space, right, is like, even if you're getting like a fraction of a percent of margin or profit off of every transaction, like you then multiply that out by, you know, the billions and billions of dollars of flows and the number of transactions that you now have going cross border every day. Like, even if you're making like in our case, you know, say you were to send $1,000 to British pounds, like the way my company set up, we probably would make, you know, 0.1% or so on that transaction, right? But that might not sound like a lot, but that's almost 100% margin, A. And then B, if you multiply that out by like millions and millions of dollars in monthly flows, suddenly you're talking about, you know, a couple $100,000 of net revenue just from, you know, that 0.1% margin that we're taking. So it definitely all adds up. And a lot of times there are, you know, the consumer is not really aware, I guess, that it's already sort of built into that final price that they're paying. So
yeah, I feel like that's a thing that a lot of finance people understand, the power of like taking a half a percentage point or whatever off loads of different interactions or transactions.
Yeah.
When we're talking about scalability before, it's like that's very right. scalable.
And high margin, right? It's not very like once you are sort of like once our system, our platform is plugged into like an Uber or whatever, like it just goes and it churns every day and it scales every day, right? You don't need to like you don't have to be like need to be doing like physical labor, like manually scaling it up, right? It's you know, it sort of goes by itself with the transactions and the volumes there. So that's the other reason why fintechs, I would say, are so popular and have gotten so much attention and venture capital money and stuff like that, just because how easy they are to scale while being minimally, you know, labor intensive. And a lot of the work is just more on the compliance and regulatory side. And once you have that, figured out, it's just a scalability thing.
Yeah. Speaking, not necessarily for your case specifically, but generally speaking, I feel like scalability is the hardest thing for a lot of businesses to sort out. Because I feel like there's a lot of good ideas that are just floating around in like the marketplace, I guess. And the scalability part, whether it's the production side or the manufacturing side or the whatever it is, I feel like that's always the hardest bit to solve. Right. And that's what separates like the giants of, has that been your experience dealing with different businesses as well?
Yeah, exactly. And sort of maybe why you see a lot of the tech companies and the sort of the biggest US companies, right, are not very, to your point, like don't require things like huge manufacturing facilities or any of that stuff. Like a lot of it is just built on like technology stacks, which can be done via, two computers and two guys or whatever like that. I mean, how Google started or how any of these sort of like non-hardware companies started, it's super easy to just scale them and grow them while requiring sort of minimal sort of venture capital money or other sort of investments and, huge margins as well. I think that's a big piece. If you're talking about like something like the car industry, right, where it's like, yeah, we might be selling these cars for $35,000, but then the parts itself or like the whole manufacturing process might have cost $28,000, right? And so it's just such a like, and then you have to pay whoever the dealership is, and then there's the whatever, and all of a sudden it's like, even when you look at the final margin, it's like maybe percentage points as opposed to something like I said with my company. I mean, I think we average like 70, 80, 90% margins on these payouts because it's such a sort of scalable, you know, not very capital intensive space that we're in. So
how did you end up there? Or like not necessarily at your company, but like in that industry? Like, was that something you wanted to do? Like when you went to school, was that something that you were looking to do, be in the like financial industry generally speaking, or this specifically, was that something that you wanted to do?
Yeah, it's actually not. I mean, I think this goes maybe a little bit back to some of my sort of educational backgrounds or that story. So, so I graduated from Stanford in 2016. My degrees were actually in renewable energy engineering as well as creative writing. So I've always been someone who's, I always said I want to use both sides of the brain, right? The sort of the engineering tech side as well as sort of more the liberal arts, being able to write, speak, present, et cetera, has always been like really important to me as well. So that was a big part of my sort of education growing up is being able to sort of use both sides of that brain, right? Ironically, like the sort of niche I sort of fell into coming out of school was in sales, because I don't feel like, you know, sales a lot of times is something that people like sort of go to school or study or plan to be in. But, you know, found I was able to be pretty successful there because of that idea of, hey, I'm someone who actually can understand the tech side. I can walk through customers, like, here's our technical documentation, here's how the product works, whatever it may be on more of the tech focus side, as well as having more of the empathetic approach of being able to, you know, it sounds basic, but like write a good email, deliver a good presentation, speak at conferences, whatever it may be. And I think that's where, having that both sides of the brain education has been able to allow me to be successful in my career. Shortly coming out of school, I got a position with like a data analytics company here in the DC area. So nothing related to sort of the financial services or financial services industry, but about 18 months into that, we were acquired by MasterCard. So MasterCard acquired this company that was about 150, 200 person company that I was working for. It was doing pretty well at. And they sort of brought us in to sort of start a whole new like data and analytics team within MasterCard. And so that's sort of how I got pushed into, I would say, like the general financial services industry. You know, then fast forward a few years then from there, you know, had a couple other jobs and sort of snowballed from, you know, working at MasterCard. Obviously, it's a big name, reputable name. Yes, I did get exposure while I was there to some of the more the financial products that they offer and sell. And then, you know, I'm now two jobs away from there, but have sort of stuck within that broader fintech space stemming from that. And I think, you know, as far as like career advice, like I think people still look at my resume a lot and they see like MasterCard. So it's good to have at least like one anchor brand to be like, yeah, the two other companies I work for is maybe more startups, more like in the fintech world, right? But it definitely helps on the resume to have like MasterCard as like an anchor brand to be like, okay, people know and recognize that. They at least sort of see like, hey, you probably have some legitimacy, I would say, within like the financial services sector broadly. But no, definitely did not like study this industry specifically. I would say it's hard to like study fintechs or financial services even more broadly. I mean, if you do want to like work for like, you know, as an asset manager, like a Goldman or like something like that, or, you know, Morgan Stanley, like, yes, it usually requires some sort of business economics degree, I would say, but broadly, like working either, you know, in tech sales or anything like that, like there's no sort of one size fits all degree, I would say.
Yeah. You know, what's nutty about that? I feel like there's a lot of like the industry that I work in, also you can't really go to school for. It's like, it feels very, it's like you go to school either for like the hard sciences or something else. But then I know so many people that are like, that are in an industry and it's their degree doesn't match, or they're like, well, you can't really go to school for that kind of, because that doesn't really exist in school. Like the private sector moves in such ways, influenced by the like the broader market, economic marketplace of, okay, there's a need there. Somebody's going to figure out an idea to go fill that need. How is it going through the acquisition of the MasterCard acquisition? Was that like, what's that process? Like if you're in a company and then it gets bought out, like if you had to kind of relay your experience to say like somebody who might go through that in the future, like what was it like, and what would your advice be, and kind of like I guess that.
Yeah, I would say candidly, like it's not that easy. As far as, you know, I mentioned we had, it was about 150, 200 person company in Arlington, Virginia that was acquired by MasterCard. And you know, we had actually like a very young, sort of vibrant, like tech focused company culture, I would say. You know, things like, you know, even back then it was kind of cool how it was like snacks were always in the office and ping pong tables and
beanbag chairs.
Yeah, it was a good group and a good culture. And then, you know, usually when you're doing an acquisition, it's one sort of bigger, you know, dinosaur company sort of taking over the other, right? And yeah, I mean, I think MasterCard had good intentions where, and still to this day, they have like a whole data, and they call it data and services team now, that was sort of born out of that acquisition. And there are people who have gone on to do really well, but almost within the first year, like I would say half of that cohort that I had that was with was gone, just because, you know, it's MasterCard treats their employees really well. It's a very, you know, globally recognized brand, but the reality is like, it's not as sort of entrepreneurial. It's not like, it's very different, right? From working from a 200 person company, you're starting all of a sudden, like I got put into like, I was like a level 8 employee and I reported to this level 7. And like, I kid you not, there was no one who had been level 7 who was under 35 years old. And so it was kind of like, so cool, I'm going to like sit at this like level 8, you know, global account manager sort of position for seemingly 10 years kind of thing. Right. And so it was, just some of like the policies and sort of the pace of things and sort of the cultural fits, like a lot of it clashed, right? There was, you know, it was definitely a much older crowd with MasterCard that they're trying to like integrate us into and all that stuff. So yeah, it was tough, and that company culture was done and dead within, I would say, the first year. And, you know, people like including myself, like you know, right as COVID was sort of happening, decided it was time for a change, because it was you know, I missed in my sort of personality is more that entrepreneurial vibe and mindset, and, you know, did well there for about another 18 months, but it wasn't like, you know, couldn't sort of see myself there long-term. It would have felt like settling when I was whatever 26 or 27 years old, and didn't think it was sort of time to settle. So
yeah, no, that makes total sense. Were you guys, was that company that got acquired, was that in, so I know some people that work in the like the biotech pharmaceutical type space, and oftentimes the business model of a startup there is they start to develop what looks like will be a good or successful drug, and then they get bought out by a Pfizer or Moderna or whatever, and then they just go start a new company with the money that they used that they got paid from the buyout, and then they just do it again. And that's the business model of like the entrepreneurial types that are within that space.
Right.
Were you guys in a similar situation where a bunch of you left to go start a new startup? Like, is it your startup or did you guys join a new one? Or like, is that a thing that happens in your industry as well?
Yeah. I would say so. You know, the bigger players in fintechs. Yeah. I mean, the MasterCards, the Visas or the big banks or something like that. You see a lot of times when they do a big acquisition, which, you know, there might be some strategic intention of, like, from in MasterCard's case, building out this whole data analytics group, right? That was, you know, a potentially a good idea, and was bringing this, you know, young, hot new company and integrating their technology and all that stuff. But, you know, the reality is that, to your point, like, there's going to be a certain number of people, though, that led that startup to be so successful that are not going to be sort of happy, I guess, at a MasterCard longer term. And so, a bunch of people from that cohort either went to smaller startups. You know, I went to a different one that was in the buy now, pay later space right from that. And so was like a 40-person company or 50-person company at that time. So some people sort of even went back to school, like sort of got their MBAs from that, signing from that or whatever it may be. So it was kind of a mix. And like I said, there were some people that are still to this day, still at MasterCard and still, you know, cause they do treat their employees really well. If it's something like, hey, I'm just thinking about starting a family, like the MasterCard maternity and paternity policy, just like an example, is like best in class. Right. And it's like a great, some people saw it as a great opportunity to like, settle down, start a family while working the MasterCard job, right? So it's definitely a mix. But yeah, in the fintech space, there is definitely a culture of like, okay, cool, we got it to a size and sort of a strength that we're able to sell to like a big guy, like now let's like make sure the acquisition goes through and so the integration process is sort of done or as done as it could be, and then off to sort of start the next new thing.
Yeah, that's really, I've been, that like business model for an individual, for an entrepreneur, is very intriguing, I'll say, because it could be very lucrative, but you have to keep coming up with new ideas, because as soon as you sell the last idea, then you have to come up with a new one that will actually work. And then that's like, that cycle is
right.
I the tech and like those sort of super fast moving industries is very, the people that are doing that nonstop and starting new companies and stuff, like those guys are like, and girls, hats off to them, because that can't be easy. I would imagine, even like I'm wired, I'd say fairly similarly to you, but even I can't really imagine just that being my life. Like, oh, let me build up a new thing just so I can sell it and then start another new thing and just have that be like that revolving door seems like. It's like,
yeah. I mean, take like the fintech space, right? Even 3 years ago, like the hot thing, and I jumped on it. I worked for it for a little over a year. Was that, like I mentioned, the buy now pay later craze, right? That's already sort of done. If you look at most of those valuations, dusted. I don't think that industry is ever really coming back to what it was at the peak, right? And now I work at a cross border payments space, right? I would say if you're going to start a cross border payments company tomorrow, it would really struggle to take off because it's now already such a commoditized industry, right? There's players like us, there's, you know, there's five other players already that are already at, you know, $1 billion valuations. Like, good luck, like really differentiating yourselves at that point, right? So it's all about, like, you know, to your point, like figuring out what that next thing is. And I'm sure in 3 years from now, like, you know, maybe starting a cross-border payments company might not be the sort of hot new thing, right? But I'm sure that there'll be some, you know, something else that's not even like around yet right now, right? That the founders of today will be jumping on, so.
Yeah. All right, Les, I think I don't know. Do you have anything else to add for people that would be curious about the space or maybe not financial advice? I don't know, anything, any like last nickels on the subjects or anything that you want to clarify or add before we jump on to other things?
No, I would just say, I mean, the coolest thing about what I do now with sort of the cross-border space is, and I think you kind of touched on that, right? It's like truly seeing how like interconnected the world is, and now how now like you could be a software engineer in Nigeria, and you could, I mean, I see people that that my company's paying out to now, they're making tens of thousands of dollars a month, right? Doing like side gigs and side hustles and projects for like Google or whoever, maybe whatever US tech company you want to name, that's sort of posting on these freelancer platforms, right? And then, you know, the world is just like you could just do it from anywhere now. You know, I think that that's really interesting. And hearing these stories about how like $50,000 of salary or whatever in some of these more remote places across the world, like that goes so much further, right? And you're able to like build a house for your family, and you're able to then, yeah, it develops in a whole ecosystem around that, right? Which brings more wealth and more equity to all these places that, you know, traditionally would just like US, you know, Silicon Valley tech companies, whatever. Like you could be a software engineer now from anywhere in the world and get paid a pretty good amount in like US dollar equivalents, right? And you know, I think that that's such a cool time to be around, right? And you can also like get the majority of a software engineer education just off of YouTube, right? So yeah, I think it's, as far as like sort of the global reach of sort of payments and sort of the tech space, it's like it's a very cool time to be in it right now, because I think we're going to start seeing some really cool projects and stuff like that from people around the globe, like not just concentrated like in Silicon Valley or in US tech circles. So
Yeah, 100%. It's interesting you mentioned the freelance stuff. I had a guy on, Carl Swanepoel. He's like a he's starting a freelance platform. He's based out of like the UK, but freelancing and just like you said, the ability to work on something for anyone from anywhere at any time has become a really cool thing that people who are driven and really want to do well for themselves have, I think, more opportunity than ever before, really. To make a good living for themselves, whether it's a side hustle or whatever, to supplement income and do all these things. It's a really exciting time, I think, for people that are really driven and really want to do well for themselves. So
yeah.
and there's a lot of things that are going along with that, like you guys and the freelance platforms like Fiverr and some of these platforms and like you said, you can get a whole education on YouTube and I've touched on that on show a bunch of times about the value of a college versus just going on YouTube and looking up how to do something. That's a broader discussion for a different time, but times are changing for sure, and I think it's very exciting for a lot of people, and also kind of I likened it to like the Wild West. And it'll be there's lots of opportunities to be had in the coming years, I think. So, well, and now actually, so yeah, all cool things, I think. For sure. All right, let's jump to soccer. So you have started a team called Blazers FC, which was inspired by the Men in Blazers podcast. Shout out to those guys. Those guys are great. But the club ownership thing is something that I think is a big differentiator for you. So I want you to touch on that and kind of how it works, because I don't know if people understand, or I haven't heard you mention it really that much to the players, but I've seen you post it on the socials and stuff. So touch on that and kind of how it works a bit.
So started Blazers Football Club, I guess like almost like a year and a half ago now at this point. Actually stemmed from a lot of conversations that we had, honestly, and sort of last winter we were doing, I think we were averaging maybe two-ish times a week. We were sort of training together over the winter and stuff like that, and a lot of those ideas sort of came out of those sessions together. But the whole idea of me starting that team was that I always wanted to be independent, right? And it was my little way, I think, of giving back in a way. I know it maybe sounds a little bit cocky to just say that, as you know, me myself being relatively young, but starting a club where I found like I feel like there was like a this niche of like I call it the 20-year-old to like the 25-year-old range, right? And I think that that's kind of like a underserved like community, especially among soccer and in other sports as well, where like guys might have played at the NCAA level, or might not have. Maybe the NCAA system wasn't right for them. they're of this high quality where they might have sort of professional or semi-professional aspirations, right? They want to keep they want to continue playing the game at the highest level possible. But you know, they're also sort of, I guess, a little bit unsure about what's next, starting a career. Can they sort of balance the two of them and all that stuff? And so that was sort of the idea behind Blazers, is that I wanted it to be a what I call a player-owned club. So I, you know, formed the company Blazers Football Club LLC in Virginia. So it's a Virginia company. I was, you know, 100% of the owner of the company. And the idea behind it being that, you know, as players sort of invested time and energy and resources into the club, that you can actually earn sort of ownership stake and shares of the company. And so, you know, tentatively I had plans like, you know, if guys played 20 games for the club, they would earn the equivalent essentially like of a percentage point of the club. Obviously that would not be scalable if over many years. And so there had to be some stopping of that, but especially rewarding the guys who were there from the beginning and sort of helping grow the foundations of the club to be able to sort of be part of the ownership structure and feel like at least they were part of growing the team was like really important to me. So, you know, I don't plan on ever having the team sort of be part of some broader youth organization. I think teams that do that, that's fine. That's great. And there are plenty of benefits. Trust me, of I'm feeling some of the pain, I guess, of not having sort of a youth, either, you know, a city or a county backed, you know, sort of youth program, sort of as a parent of the club and sort of wanting to stay fully independent and sort of some of the issues and sort of how difficult it might be for things like field permits and all that stuff. It definitely makes it a little bit harder being totally independent, but also wanted to build the culture and everything from sort of how we present ourselves to the culture to the guys that we're bringing on board and stuff like that with a very specific mindset and way that I wanted to control. And so that's sort of the thoughts and sort of the idea behind it.
Do you have plans to add in kind of a, I don't know if mentorship is the right word, but guys that want to play, but you also, you or whoever's part of the club is doing this to help with like resumes or a player is like, oh, I've got an interview at this. Like, is that part of it also?
That's actually exactly it. Yeah. So the guys know, and I know you've been around them a little bit. So I definitely wanted to build a little bit like of that family culture and sort of the, again, I'm not saying that I know everything and I've made plenty of mistakes in my work career and my sports career and all that stuff, but I want to be there as like a resource and an outlet for these guys. Again, another thing I found is that sometimes I just didn't know sort of like, hey, can you help me with this resume process? Or can you help, like in the last 6 months, I think I've written a college coach recommendation. I've updated two resumes. I've done a job recommendation for another guy. And it's like knowing that they have me as a resource for that. And even just to bounce ideas off of, you know, that's something that I'm really proud of and, you know, want to make that a part of the team culture as well, because the reality, right, is that soccer is not sort of the end all be all for everyone. I want to make it sort of the highest competitive level possible. Right. But I always tell guys like, you know, family, health, work, you know, come before soccer. Obviously you have to have a certain level of commitment and stuff like that, but know that sort of myself and I think other members of the team are there for you if any of those three things, you know, other three parts of your life like need help or assistance. So
yeah, I think it's a really unique take on it. I found this as well, right? The same as you have made loads of mistakes, but I often find like younger for us is like not that much younger, but players who kind of just don't know what to do with themselves. They're like, oh, I wanted to play in JUCO and now they played in JUCO and then they wanted to go to this school and it didn't work out. Now they're just like stuck and they don't know what to do. Right. And having from a broader societal level, having those sorts of people just be stuck is not really good.
Yeah.
But for them as at the micro, at the individual level, being a platform or an environment to help people kind of get their lives together is a really, I think, I don't know if noble's the right word, but it's a very good undertaking, I'd say. And that's a really cool spin on kind of just, because lots of people just start teams and that's fine.
Yeah.
But that's a really cool spin on it. And I think one of the reasons why, like, I want to come around and I've been talking to some of the guys, and I'm here when I'm there when I can, of course. And but I is one of the reasons why I was drawn to it. And obviously, we've known each other for a while before you started it, but I think it's a really cool spin on it.
Yeah, because my personal take is that, you know, especially going through like the high school years, right? Your life is so pre-planned, literally, mm-hmm. right? From 7:30 a.m. till if you have soccer practice right after school, right? You're getting home at 7:30. Let's say you're having dinner, hopefully during homework, going to bed, starting it. And suddenly I feel like what I'm seeing with a lot of these guys is to your point, you gave that example of like, hey, maybe the NCAA system or JUCO system didn't exactly work out how they wanted. Suddenly they're 21 years old and they're like, I have to now fill my day, if that makes sense, right? And it's it's tough. It's could be overwhelming to be like, where do I even start to apply like my skills? Maybe I am really interested in computer science, right? And maybe I want to start looking to some sort of, you know, junior programming position or something like that. Where do I even start? And I don't think that the current sort of educational system sort of preps you for that. And there is this gap that I found between like that 20 to 25 year old range. And I, you know, beyond just soccer, want to sort of provide a space for guys that to be able to get some help or sort of guidance or advice on, you know, really kickstarting being an adult and sort of that adult phase of your life, right?
Yeah, and the ones that get that kickstart are really have an advantage moving forwards, because like people, there are some people that don't get their lives figured out until they're like 30, 35, whatever the case may be is. And if you're able to have some sort of foundation from your earlier mid-20s, you're on, like, you have such an advantage time-wise of being able to accrue things. And maybe you want to buy a house or you want to do this. Like, you have more time. You have time on your side. Yeah, 100%. And even if somebody, let's say they want to go back to school, it's like, I'm not coming right out of high school. How do I like put that on the application? Like, speaking for myself, if I tried to go JUCO and it didn't really work, I wouldn't even know how to apply to school at that point, because there's no guidance counselor. You can't like go back to school, right, high school, and be like, oh, guidance counselor, can you help me with whatever? Like, it doesn't exist. Like, you're just on your own, and figuring stuff out on your own is not fun, really.
There are times where I even recognize that like Blazer, for example, is not the end all. I mean, obviously I love it. I can tell there are guys that are part of the team that are committed because they've already maybe started their careers in the DC area and they have a partner or a girlfriend or a wife. And so that, you know, I could see them being longer term partners of the Blazers football club. But I also am not naive enough to think that like everyone that like that's the end all goal, be all goal is to play UPSL for the Blazers. Right. And so wanting to be there and to support them, whatever that sort of next step in the journey is. Maybe that could be going back to the college. Maybe, you know, we have two guys who are just came back from Portugal, and so that maybe didn't go as well as they would have liked. And so they're thinking about, you know, doing international trials again in the future. So whatever it may be, like the team is there to support. And yes, we're the goal is to play at the highest competitive and highest quality level soccer in the DMV area. That's always and should be the North Star for the club. But there's also people, it's also meant to be sort of a supportive family for sort of wherever you are on your, you know, both playing / career / life journey. So,
yeah, no, that's really great. It's something that I've found to be more important to me the last maybe 2-3 years. Some of the guys that like last winter we were training with were searching for different things, and similar to you, I've had people be like, hey, what should I do about this job thing, or I don't know what I should do about blank, or even like relationship, like we're both married, so sometimes guys will be like, oh, my girlfriend, like I don't know what to do about this, like how would you, and like just having somebody to bounce ideas off, because I don't know, because you remember like when you were in school, like you ask your friend for advice is like the worst advice on planet Earth most of the time. It's like, oh, yeah, you should just ignore them. It's like, no, that doesn't work in real life. So to have somebody there that knows it's, yeah, it can be invaluable. Sure.
It's and hopefully, like I said, I don't want it to ever come across as a place of like, I know better than you. And, you know, because I've been successful, this is how you should do it. Right. Like, I like to think, and I know you know me, that's coming more from a genuine place of like empathy, yeah, and like wanting to help people. You know, if you can make fun of my high school sort of all you want as a hoity-toity private high school in the area, but like what our motto was, men for others, you know, and I think that ironically, is like probably the part of high school that's probably stuck with me forever. And I genuinely have like a goal or a desire to like help guys as needed, especially given, you know, like we've talked about, I identified over the playing soccer just in the area over the last few years that like that's a pretty like underserved community there.
Yeah. I don't think there's anything wrong though with I think both of us have and will continue to acknowledge that we are still like always learning new things and we've made mistakes and we don't know everything. But at the same time, there's a general framework for how to be successful as a person, especially in the US, like how it kind of works itself out, how like the job world shakes itself out. There's like a general framework for how to be successful that we've both kind of followed in right. different industries or whatever the case may be is, but there's a general kind of way of, hey, you should conduct yourself in this way in the job interview. And hey, your resume should kind of look generally like this. And hey, you should generally do these sorts of things. And those sorts of things, I don't think there's anything wrong with saying like, hey, we've kind of figured that part out, generally speaking, and we are able to, and that's more than a lot of people would have been taught, especially like it's not an easy thing to sort of to figure out, really. I don't think so, because there's people that I work with that I'm like, how did you get hired? Or like that I've worked with in the past, or like people that I know that I'm like, you're 30. What do you mean your resume looks like this? Because they'll be like, hey, Eric, I know that you have a job. Can you look at my resume? And I'm like, has no one ever looked at this before? Right, and so I don't think there's anything wrong with saying like, hey, we can still provide a valuable resource. But to your point, like life, like we're still learning for sure, always. And that's kind of, that also helps with the ethos of the club, I think, is that everyone can learn from each other at a certain point, a certain aspect, like, as it comes to its full, maybe conclusion is not maybe the right word, but you know what I mean.
Yeah. I like to say I run the club like a benevolent dictatorship, right? Like ultimately I have the final say, right? But even like in our group chats and or email threads and stuff like that, I'm always phrasing things and always sort of seeking advice or guidance in a very democratic way, right? To be like, hey, we're doing practices on Wednesdays at 8:30. Like, does that work for people? You know, as opposed to saying what it is, like that's maybe a basic example, right? But I'm always trying to get again, sort of going back to the culture, to your point of like wanting guys to like they're involved in decision making, and hopefully there are little life lessons that come along with that too. So
yeah, and it helps with buy-in if people feel empowered to like they feel like they're a part of it. It helps with the commitment and that sort of thing for sure. So yeah, yeah. I like what you're doing for sure, 100%.
Yeah, definitely was. I mean, I know you know this. I mean, so we're. Yeah, whatever, 14 months or so into starting the club, right? It definitely had its rocky moments. You know, we started off in the Virginia Super League, VSSL, over the last two seasons. The first game was, I was terrified last spring, right? To be like, I remember I had 18 guys text me that like, oh yeah, I'm coming. They were all on the roster and stuff like that. And as we approached kickoff, which was a 9 p.m. kickoff, like on a Wednesday at Bryan High School, which is way out in Alexandria, right? And it was like a horror movie for me, right? It was like one guy texted like, hey, sorry, something came up at work, can't make it anymore. Another guy hey, car problems, you know, sorry, can't have it. And oh, feeling sick, whatever. And just one by one. And then, you know, I think we started against SYC with like nine guys on the field or something like that, and it was just like I want to just like curl up into a hole and like, you know, was so embarrassed, because here I was all not cockily but thinking like, oh, we got this great lineup of 18 guys. I know you know some of the guys are on the original roster. Like if all 18 had come, like we were going to be in pretty good shape and had some good quality guys and stuff like that. And it just, you know, it was tough to get that buy-in at first. And, you know, the culture didn't come sort of right off the bat, right? And now I'm finally at the point where, you know, we had 37 guys out on last Wednesday. And so it's sort of ballooned in this thing of like, these are all guys who want to be here, even on a cold, rainy night in the middle of the week at 9 p.m., right? You have 37 guys showing up that want to get better, that want to improve. And so, yeah, my point just being like the culture part definitely did not come easy. There definitely some, it wasn't like I just snapped my fingers and I had a great Blazers team culture, right? But especially with, like, the PSL season coming up this spring and everything like that, I think that we're at a good place to buy in with a good group of guys. And, you know, hopefully we'll keep improving now on sort of the final pieces of quality and sort of the technical aspect of the game. So,
yeah, 100%. And I know one of the things that, so I want to ask you about this because you make your captions on some of your posts are quite humorous. But you talk about pressing a lot, and the Gegen pressing master Jurgen Klopp is leaving Liverpool at the end of the season. Who's your Prem team? I don't remember.
Manchester United. So I hate Liverpool, but it's
so
fine.
You're probably happy about that, but you can appreciate Klopp, no?
Yeah, the true father of gegenpress is Ralf Rangnick. So he
that's a fair point. Yes. That's a fair point. But what are your thoughts on the Premier League so far? And Manchester United has been, well, I don't really know what you guys are doing, to be completely honest.
I don't either. I've been a diehard Premier League fan ever since I was a kid. I mean, obviously I grew up, my first real like soccer watching memory, 5 years old, the treble, Manchester United, the Solskjaer goal, everything like that. And so I'm like your stereotypical, like, was 5 years old, impressionable, won the treble, were like good my whole childhood kind of thing. And obviously since the Sir Alex Ferguson departure, it's been a bit of a rocky road. But I love the Premier League. I hate to say it, but the 2018-19 Liverpool, I believe, is my favorite team I've ever watched. And
but the Champions League winning one or the Premier League winning
The Champions League winning one. Yeah. Just the front one. I feel like it was peak. So that front three of Firmino, Salah, Mane. And so you'll see in a lot of my sort of instructions to guys and stuff like that, it's all based off of their pressing cues that they went off of, right? It's all about like trapping their right back between the end line. You'll have Salah running at him one way. You have Firmino, you'll have Henderson closing down the six. It's all like meant on trapping the guys in the corner with the ball and either forcing them to kick it long where you have someone like Van Dijk to just easily clean it up and then recycle and go again. Or, you know, you get a costly turnover and guess what? You can swing the ball over to Mane and he's probably gonna, you know, put it in the back of that. So that team and sort of the intensity and sort of the pressing cues that they went off of is still, I think, to this day, second to none. But so I'm kind of like the opposite of like the tiki-taka sort of Barca style. Like I hate watching Manchester City. I can appreciate someone like De Bruyne, but to me, like, I don't enjoy soccer where it's like, hey, we had 900 passes this game, the other team had 100, and you know, kind of one of those kind of games. And so, but my whole philosophy is that but that doesn't also always mean you win with 900 passes, right? There are plenty of times where Manchester City has lost 1-0 with having whatever 75% possession. So, as far as the sort of Premier League is going this year, Manchester United looks like a disaster. I have no idea sort of what our plan is, what style of play we play even is. There are times where I feel like, we almost look better when we're playing on the counterattack, which is ironic because that's what like Ole, what Solskjaer was like fleeing for, that he didn't have any sort of tactics and just played on the counterattack. But how sometimes it's set up with guys like Rashford and sort of the pace that we have on the wing is like a lot of times that looks like the best way to play. And it definitely is not like a full pressing system or like total football system either. So it's very confusing for me as a Manchester United fan.
Because are you Ten Hag out, or are you like, where are you with, because a lot of people are Ten Hag out. A lot of people are like, no, give him time. And then a lot of people are like the whole thing is a shambles. Like, where are you? Where have you made a decision on him as a manager yet?
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to know exactly what goes on, sort of like with the how I see it is like judging off of like the players that a manager tries to bring in, right? And then how does he incorporate them, or what style does he play with those players, right? So I think of like Anthony is one. If you're on like I'm big like on the Manchester United subreddit, right? Everyone on the subreddit hates Anthony, and he's like the biggest, like, how the heck that guy was worth whatever he 80 million pounds or whatever it was is 100. Like crazy to me, because he literally can only cut inside, can only use his left foot. It allows sort of defenders and everything like that to set up so much easier because they know he's always just going to cut inside, right? But even sort of beyond that, sort of that was obviously like a Ten Hag approval, right? He played with him at Ajax and all that stuff. And so that's where you start to have less and less confidence in manager, because like this was someone that you picked that supposedly sort of knows your system, but you can't really identify what the identity is of Manchester United. I think that's the most frustrating thing, and why I am at this point Ten Hag out, because you know, you now had whatever, a year and a half to be like, at least impose your system, right? Like Arsenal and Arteta like started off slower, but you can now see what they were building towards. And now it's sort of the full evolution of it is coming into play, right? Like I said, with Manchester United, some games, like, are you in a sit back sort of lower block counter press or counter attack team? Are you in a full on gegenpress? Are you in a more like, it's just hard to tell what's their style and what's their identity. And I think that's like the biggest sort of red flag for Ten Hag, and why, you know, he's obviously like not getting buy-in from the players at this point. So,
yeah, I don't disagree with anything you said. I do wonder though, like I did this a friend of mine named Mustafa, he's a Chelsea fan, but he's also a big Premier League fan, and we went through like the personnel that Manchester United had, because he was also saying Ten Hag out, and I'm like, but you guys, in my opinion, based on the players that you have, are exactly where you should be. And I don't know that, like, based on identity and stuff, I fully agree, but if you went down like man for man, you guys are not probably almost doing, I don't want to say overachieving, but I think he overachieved last year.
Yeah, for sure.
And so I'm kind of like, if he wasn't there, would you guys be worse? Because I look at like who, like Onana's been horrendous, and right. And I don't know like if that was, because you also don't know. So Anthony, I'm like with you, that's probably a Ten Hag signing. But some of the other ones, I'm like, are they Ten Hag signings? Is that the Glazers doing stuff? So I don't know. I don't even know if it's a counter. That's the only thing I would add. If you're starting with Lindelof and Johnny Evans, it's not a recipe for success,
right? Yeah. So then, yeah, there are definitely times where like I see the starting lineup, and it's more just like, hey, you cocky Manchester United fan, do you just need to like reset what your expectations are? Because to your point, like the starting 11 that we have right now, if it's like, yeah, there was one where I remember it was like, yeah, Evans and Lindelof, and then in front of him was like McTominay and someone else or something to be an Anthony on the wing, like this. You know, you put this starting 11 against any of the other top four, big four teams, and like you would 10 times out of 10 take the other rosters, right? And so, yeah, that is where I guess you have a little bit of, I don't know if sympathy is the right word, but yeah, it's the same Manchester United problem that we've always had since I feel like Sir Alex Ferguson left, of just buying players overpriced at the wrong time on inflated wages, and it just like kills everything, right? I mean, even like this year, like Casemiro has dipped, he's gotten injured a lot more. I mean, guys like Varane have gotten injured a lot more. I mean, obviously, if you're bringing in Evans and stuff like that, it's just, so it's very rarely now does it seem like we're buying the right player who's with the right motivation, like on the upswing. Like maybe people were saying like, oh, maybe that'll be Anthony, like buying him right in his prime after he's always already proven himself an Eredivisie, right? And it's just gone the opposite way. So it's almost like, you know, you need to get back to buying a great 22-year-old who's ascending and who still has that motivation, that drive, as opposed to like a post 5 Champions League Casemiro who, you know, has not looked like himself the last year.
Well, was the plan with Sancho, I think. And I don't know what your take on that situation was. And I didn't really do too much research into it. But all I know is that he wasn't playing at all for you guys. And now he's back to Dortmund, which is the team that I support, right? He lit the world on fire at Dortmund. He was amazing the first go around. He got 30 minutes the first game, and then he's been starting ever since with us. And you can tell he's not match sharp, right? Like, he looks sharp compared to everybody else because he's that talented. But compared to him, you can tell there's a little bit of rust. But he's like got an assist, won penalties, like he's making impacts on the game. And so to back to like the Ten Hag out point, it's like you want your manager to help develop, like to get your players motivated to play, and then to help them improve, and then to find their identity are like the three things. And so I can't really point to anyone that's gotten better under Ten Hag, but you also don't know if that's like a behind the scenes, everything is in such a shambles that guys are just like, yeah, I'll just collect my giant wages and go whatever. And so it's like, what's the fix? Like, I don't know what the fix is.
Yeah, exactly. Is it to just start a full academy roster because they're generally on cheaper wages because they haven't gotten that bigger second contract? I'm not saying that is the answer, but it's almost like you need a total reset because it was just, and you know, throughout the Sir Alex Ferguson, or throughout the post Sir Alex Ferguson era, it's just like wages getting higher and higher. And I think, you know, there are people who are on, I don't actually know the exact details. I think some of it's a little bit confidential, just the, but the rumors of like what the weekly wages of some of the guys are on, and you're just like, you know, there's no way that they deserve. And then you see the guy who's on 300K per week or whatever like that being benched. And then suddenly the 150K per week guy is like, well, if you're making me play every week, but the 300K per week guy gets to sit on the bench, like, oh, well, I want 300K or else I'm going to put up a fuss. You know, it's just like the inflated wage bill problem just, I feel like, creates a snowball effect. And it's been that way for close to 10 years where no one is ever going to be happy because they see the guy who's just sitting there collecting 300K per week, not doing anything, and they also want that. So.
Yeah. And the other thing, we've seen managers come and go and have some success elsewhere. David Moyes is having success at West Ham, and a few others have had, like Ranić had a lot of success within the Red Bull organization, and Ten Hag obviously was successful at Ajax. And obviously, that's not as big of a club, but you look at the roster of guys who've been there from like, maybe not from Moyes, but Solskjaer, Ragnik, and Ten Hag now. And all three of those managers have failed, and it's been the same guys. And so I don't really know. I don't, like, it sucks to see such a big brand just like capitulate like that. There's been a few, Barcelona as well, is kind of in that boat, and a few others, but it's Chelsea for one. But it's been, I don't know. I don't know, man. I'm hoping something changes, because I would love to see like true top six battles in the Prem, not like, yeah. Although, no, like this, although this year,
7-0,
yeah. Oh, no. Although this year, top three is shaping up to be quite competitive. So, which is better than City winning it every time. Although I can't say much because Bayern has won our league for the last like 10 years in a row, but it's a different story for a different day.
Yeah, it's the whole idea of, you know, the commercial and sort of the global nature of the club becoming bigger than the actual sort of like quality and sort of drive of players on the pitch. I mean, tying it back to the whole Blazers thing, right? Like, I am very big on like just guys' personal sort of ethos on sort of, you know, how they play the game, how they approach the game, their love for the game. Like, do they actively like want to be out there and practice? And I, you know, as a semi sort of hybrid sort of coach, manager, owner, right? I will 10 times out of 10 go with a guy who wants to be there, is motivated to come out to sessions, is asking me about like, hey, can you look at this video from minute 7 to minute 9? Because, you know, I want feedback on, you know, what I should change as like a left winger in the system or whatever it may be. Like, guys who have that hunger and that drive, like, you want them 10 times out of 10, right, to play for your team, as opposed to, you know, the guy who might be whatever, you know, MLS Academy level, but never wants to show up for training or workouts, or doesn't have that love or passion for the game. And so, yeah, it's tough. And I imagine, like in a lot of industries, a lot of spaces, right, once you get to that highest level of you start collecting that big paycheck, and you kind of feel like it's hard to have that sort of, you know, what would you call them, like a schoolboy drive and sort of love for the game and passion for the game that sort of gets you out there every day. So,
yeah. I feel like it's a good place to end it. It's getting late. You killed it. You got any last nickels?
Yeah, I got any last nickels. Be on the lookout for Blazers and UPSL and VSSL seasons this spring. Hopefully some big things, and sort of year two of the club taking sort of the next step. First year was, yeah, like I said, a lot of growing pains, but I think we sort of have an established sort of culture and brand and sort of identity and type of player and system that we play that, you know, we'll hopefully start to make some moves in year two. So.
Very nice. All right, for those listening, stay tuned for the next one. We'll see you guys next time. Peace.